In this part of the lecture, I will quickly give you an overview of some of the mainstream methodologies which are used worldwide for the probabilistic seismic hazard assessment. And in the next lecture, in next part of this lecture, we will study their application in Pakistan. So first, a quick review of the mainstream PSHA methodologies, and I will start with the early developments of some of the PSHA concepts. So it's a kind of a revision for all of us. We know that the early concepts of PSHA were developed in 1960s by Alan Cornell and Luis Esteva. So these were the groundbreaking efforts by these two researchers, where some of the earliest concepts of PSHA were developed. The first formulation of the PSHA was formally developed by Cornell in 1968 in his very famous paper, and the title was Engineering Seismic Risk Analysis. So this was the classical PSHA approach originally developed by Alan Cornell. The methodology was later generalized in 1970s using the total probability theorem, and then the first hazard maps were developed based on this generalized PSHA formulation. In 1960, Cornell developed the first preliminary seismic hazard map for Southern California, and then in 1970 the first national seismic hazard maps of Mexico were developed using this approach. Then the first US national seismic hazard maps were developed in 1976 by Professor Algermishin, and then they were updated in 1982 also, but those updated maps were still based on a formulation that excluded the aleatory uncertainty in ground motion estimates. In the 1990 version of the US National Seismic Hazard Maps, the developed by USGS, these were the updated maps, and then in these versions the aleatory uncertainty was explicitly considered. If we go back to the early developments, in 1977, the recognition of the finite segments of rupture, this concept was introduced. The finite segments of causative faults were recognized, and they also were considered a source of energy with finite dimensions, rather than a point source as assumed by Cornell in the original classical methodology. Then in 1974, there was another major development, and that was the concept of uniform hazard spectrum. The recognition that the ground motion equations and seismic hazard curves could be developed directly not only for peak ground acceleration but also for the structural response. And this concept was introduced and attributed primarily to Robin McGuire. Then we have the arrival of digital computers, and then with their arrival, there was no necessity for achieving the closed form solutions for the seismic hazard integral. Previously, the researchers were struggling to actually formulate the closed form methods to evaluate seismic hazard integral, but with the arrival of digital computers this issue was resolved, and then we started using numerical integration techniques to evaluate the hazard integral. So arbitrarily complex ground motion equations now was possible to use with the help of these digital computers. Then the first generation of the hazard assessment programs, computer programs, were developed, EQRISC and then FRISC also. These programs calculated the seismic hazard for both area sources as well as the crustal faults. In 1995, Robin McGuire also proposed basic concepts in the seismic deaggregation analysis in his paper, The Probabilistic Seismic Hazard Analysis and Design Earthquakes, Closing the Loop. So the basic concepts of seismic deaggregation analysis were discussed. This was also one of the major developments. In 1995, another major development in the PSHA methodologies was made, and that was made by Frankel, Arthur Frankel, in 1995. And that major development was the concept of spatially smooth gridded seismicity. Conventionally, in the Cornell methodology, the classical methodology, we define the area source zones, and within a particular area source zone, the seismicity is assumed random in both temporal domain as well as in the spatial domain. But in this concept, the concept of spatially smooth gridded seismicity, what we do actually is that we have the historical seismicity in a particular area. We smooth its seismicity rate, and then we assume each of the pixel in each of the area, we consider it as a seismic source. So we basically smooth out the historical seismicity. We don't make different source zones. We basically use the actual historical seismicity, the smoothened seismicity. We consider that whole layer of smoothened seismicity as one earthquake source. So this is a major difference compared to the classical McGuire methodology, where we actually make area source zones, and each source zone is considered, the occurrence of earthquakes are considered random within each source zone. So another major development, relatively recent development, was the formulation of the Global Earthquake Model Initiative. It was founded in Italy, and it is shortly known as GEM, Global Earthquake Model Initiative, and its purpose is, it's a combined effort from different organizations to develop a unified and global seismic hazard map, or global seismic risk model for the whole world. And one of the products offered by GEM in recent years is the program called OpenQuake, and this is a software or program to calculate the seismic hazard or forecast the seismic hazard, and it has several of the modules. It has a very detailed methodology implemented to determine seismic hazard at any seismotectonic environment. So this program has now been used all around the world to perform seismic hazard assessments. We have also used this program to carry out the seismic hazard assessment of Pakistan. It is a state-of-the-art open-source software which is collaboratively developed for earthquake hazard and risk modeling. So this is also a major development in this whole line, whole series of developments in the PSHA methodologies. So I will focus a bit more on this approach. This is the Frankel's approach, or also called as the concept of spatially smooth gridded seismicity. That what we do actually is that we smooth out the historical seismicity, and then we apply a grid on that, and each of the grid cell is treated as a seismic source. So this method, the Frankel's method, is now used widely for carrying out the hazard assessment of some of the major regions in the world. So basically, the historical seismicity is modeled in this method, all those seismicity which cannot be assigned to a specific geological structure. So if you cannot associate the historical earthquakes with a particular fault, you model them as background seismicity. It's also called as the distributed seismicity. The conventional approach of doing this is that you make area sources for all of those earthquakes which cannot be explicitly associated to a particular fault. But instead, in this approach, what we do is that we actually divide that whole region into small scales, and the number of earthquakes above a certain reference magnitude is counted in each of the scale. This count, that is the total number of events observed above a threshold magnitude, is the maximum likelihood estimate of A parameter. A parameter and B parameter are the two Gutenberg-Richter magnitude recurrence relationship parameters. So A represents the seismic activity rate, and B represents the relative seismicity or the slope of the Gutenberg-Richter relationship. So each of the cell in a particular gridded area, each of the square cell, is treated as a seismic source. So instead of, if we have a study region like this, instead of making several of the area sources like this, what we do is we actually apply a grid on the whole area in both directions, and each of the cell in that grid is treated as a seismic source. So now, in fact, we have a distributed activity rates, which is distributed and not constant in a particular seismic source zone. In the conventional procedure, if you divide the study region into, let's say, several zones, the A and B parameters or all the seismicity parameters will be constant for a particular whole region, for a particular source zone. It will not vary within that source zone because the earthquakes are assumed random, occurrence is assumed random in that source zone. But in this Frankl's concept, we actually apply a grid on the whole region, whole study region, and then each of the grid cell is treated as a seismic source. So first we do is that we basically have the historical seismicity in a particular region. We smooth it out. We basically apply a Gaussian filter to basically smooth out the historical seismicity. So this is to include the uncertainty in the earthquake location. Because what we do is that we don't use the actual locations of past earthquakes. We smooth them out and use that smoothed activity rate by applying a grid on top of that. So this approach is called the spatially smoothed gridded seismicity. So we smooth out the historical seismicity, then apply a grid on that area, and then each of the grid cell is treated as a seismic source. In order to smooth out the historical seismicity, we apply the Gaussian filter because it preserves the total number of earthquakes. So the total number of earthquakes in the smooth seismicity and the actual seismicity will be same. And finally, we apply the hazard integral to each of the square cell of that grid. We basically carry out the same hazard assessment for each of the grid cell, and then finally calculate the rate of exceedance or frequency of exceedance for a particular hazard ground motion parameter, just like we do it with conventional PSHA procedure. So this concept is now used by USGS to update the national seismic hazard maps of US. Every 3 to 4 years they update the national seismic hazard maps of US. So this is that concept of spatial smoothing of historical earthquake data. On the left hand side you have the actual historical seismicity here, and on the right hand side you see that we smooth out basically the historical seismicity, and now each grid point we basically apply a grid in the whole study region, a very fine grid like 0.1 degree to 0.1 degree. Some hazard assessments are even carried out at a very fine grid, 0.05 by 0.05 degree. So we apply that grid, and each grid we basically count the earthquake occurrence, and then we calculate the A and B parameters, which are the Gutenberg-Richter parameters for each grid cell. So using the smooth seismicity, we basically account the uncertainty associated in the location of earthquake epicenters, because there is an uncertainty with each of these historical earthquakes about the location of their epicenters. So this map on the right basically shows the smooth activity rate, the A values, in fact 10 raised to power A values, for each of the point or pixels in this map. This is another view where you can see the smooth seismicity. The 10 raised to power A values with different color ranges are shown here, and they are developed based on the actual historical seismicity, and we apply the Gaussian filter on top of that and smooth out the historical seismicity to finally come up with this smooth seismicity. Now this is modeled or treated as a seismic source instead of the conventional area sources in the classical PSHA. Then another development which I mentioned in the start was the consideration of active crustal faults in the hazard assessment, you can say, methodology. Originally we know that we started with the classical area source zone method, but then we started or recognized the consideration or the, you can say, contribution of the active crustal faults also in the hazard assessment. So here you can see it is taken from one of the studies where around 110 of the active crustal faults were actually traced, and their data was used, and they were explicitly modeled in the hazard assessment of Pakistan, and their contribution was duly taken into account. So from one of the studies, this one, which is based on the consideration of spatially smooth gridded seismicity as well as the consideration of crustal faults, this is the result of the PSHA carried out for Pakistan. So you can see here that on the left we have the map for 10% probability of exceedance in 50 years, the DBE level. This is map for PGA, and on the right hand side you can see that this is for MCE level. So since the consideration of active crustal faults was explicitly taken into account here, you can see that the seismicity pattern, the seismic hazard pattern is actually matching, or it is correlating with the seismotectonic features of the study region also. So actually we know that the plate boundary is like this, and then we have the several faults in this manner. So all the hazard because of those faults and all other, you can say, the seismotectonic features, their effect can be seen in the future forecast also. And this is due to the consideration of the active crustal faults in the hazard assessment. This is the result from another recent study. This is our own study, recently published. So you can see here that in this study also, we actually used the idea of the spatial smoothing, and also we explicitly considered those active faults which I have shown in the last few slides, and their contribution was taken into account, and then we forecasted the hazard. This is the SS, the spectral acceleration at 0.2 seconds. This is the SS map, and on the left we have the DBE level, and on the right we have the MCE level. So this is the SS map for MCE level. So you can see here the contribution of different faults and other seismotectonic features is visible in the hazard if you explicitly use this method. Okay, one of the reasons why a spatial smoothing approach is considered currently better than the conventional area source method is that we have the assumption in the conventional area sources that once the area source is defined, within that area source the seismicity is considered, the occurrence of earthquakes are considered random in time also as well as in the location also. So it means that if we have a particular study region here, for example, the forecast, the hazard forecast, is heavily dependent on how a hazard analyst actually delineates the seismic area sources. For example, two different seismic hazard analysts will use two different area sources. We have the historical seismicity, okay, in that area. One will say that, okay, I will delineate like this, okay, I will make this a big area source and then several of the small area sources. Okay, because the seismicity pattern is, let's say, not well understood. There are no clear indications of active tectonic features like faults and others. So let's say that we have to consider only the area sources in that study region. One hazard analyst will come up with a different delineation. Other will say, no, this whole big area source should be divided into maybe two or three area sources. And we know that the seismicity parameters like Gutenberg Richter A and B values, they depend on how the seismic sources are delineated, because we have to actually count the earthquakes in each of the area source and then plot the magnitude recurrence relationship, and then from that magnitude recurrence we have to extract the A and B values. So it means that the hazard forecast is dependent on how a hazard analyst delineates or divides a particular area into different area sources. Generally, there are several guidelines to do that. First, what we do is that we actually trace all the faults in a particular region. We say that, okay, this is one fault, fault A. So all of the earthquakes which are concentrated in that fault, near that fault, they are all attributed to that fault A. Then we also try to study other seismic sources, some other faults. And then in order to model those earthquake events which are not attributed to any fault, we have to have area sources, or we have to have the background seismicity. So then difference of opinion may be there. Different seismic hazard analysts may divide the area into different zones based on that. Actually, this division of area source zones should correspond to the seismotectonic features of that region. You should consider that region, the seismotectonic features of that region, in order to come up with the actual area sources. So in the next lecture, I will show you, when I will show you the hazard assessment of Pakistan. So different studies have been done using the same Cornell's classical approach, but they use different source zones. Their delineations are different. So therefore, they end up in different forecast also. I mean, one of the reason for their difference in results is that they consider different area source zones. So this approach, classical approach, have an inherent limitation. The subjectivity which is included in the analysis because of the decision made by hazard analyst. But if you use the Frankel spatial smoothing approach, you don't have to divide the region into different area sources. You just have to spatially smoothen the historical seismicity and apply a very fine grid, like 0.1 degree to 0.1 degree, and then compute the activity rate in each of the grid square. So this spatial smoothing not only accounts for the fact that if there is any uncertainty in the location of the epicenter in historical data, that uncertainty is accounted for, but also the subjectivity involved because of the decision made by hazard analyst, that can also be avoided. So this is one of the you can say the advantages of using the concept of spatially smooth gridded seismicity. No, we don't actually apply those earthquakes to structures and then calculate their response to make the spectral acceleration map. I think you missed the point. The hazard assessment can also be performed using spectral acceleration as the ground motion parameter. You know that the ground motion prediction equations, they are not only available for PGA, they are also available for spectral acceleration at different time periods. So if you go to the basic PSHA lecture, you will see that the ground motion prediction equations have different regression coefficients, and those coefficients are not only for PGA values. I mean, if you want to predict PGA using them, you can also predict spectral acceleration using GMPs. at different time periods. So this spectral acceleration map is not calculated from analysis, just like you do in structural analysis, that you build a single degree of freedom system and apply a ground motion, and the peak response acceleration is the spectral acceleration. It's not that. Basically, you carry out the whole hazard assessment using spectral acceleration as the main ground motion parameter. And then finally, you come up with, just like you come up with a PGA map, you can also come up with a spectral acceleration map at a particular time period, like 0.2 seconds or 1 second. So SA at 0.2 seconds and SA at 1 second, they are treated as ground motion parameters, okay, not the response acceleration. So these two numbers at 1 second, these two numbers SS and S1, they are just like PGA values. PGA is a ground motion parameter. The GMPE relates PGA with the source to site distance R. Similarly, the same GMPE will also be having a version where it will be relating SS with the source to site distance and S1 with the source to site distance. Okay. So, which means that the whole hazard assessment process can be carried out using SS and S1 as the ground motion parameters, and using the same procedure, finally you can come up with the hazard map for SS and hazard map for S1. I will end this short session here, and then I will explain the application of some of these methodologies on Pakistan in this next session, which I will continue right from here.